one right after, so please be prepared for the voters' assembly. Then this next week, Thursday, is our final midweek Advent service. We continue with our looking at Luke chapter 1. If you have opportunity before the 6:30 service, meal this week is going to be ham and rolls. And now you don't even have to bring your own bag. Please join us if you have opportunity, and hopefully the weather is going to hold out for us as well. God's richest blessings to you as we sing our first hymn.
Together as his people, let us take refuge in the image.
from Isaiah chapter 35. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom like the crocus. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who have an anxious heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, with the recompense of God. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a deer and the tongue of the mute sing for joy. For waters break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool and the thirsty ground springs of water. In the haunt of jackals where they lie down, the grass shall become reeds and rushes, and a highway shall be there, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it. It shall belong to those who walk on the way, even if they are fools, they shall not go astray. No lion shall be there, nor shall any ravenous beast come up on it. They shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is from James chapter 5. Be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, being patient about it until it receives the early and the late rains. You also, be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another, brothers, so that you may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. As an example of suffering and patience, brothers, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Behold, we consider those blessed who remained steadfast. You have heard of the steadfastness of Job, and you have seen the purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. This is the word of the Lord. Stand for the singing of the Alleluia and the Gospel reading. Them. And they went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds concerning John. What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind? What then did you go out to see? A man dressed in soft clothing? Behold, those who wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you. Truly I say to you, among those born of women there has arisen no one greater than John the Baptist. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets in the law prophesied until John, and if you are willing to accept it, he is Elijah who is to come. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
This morning we turn our attention to the third article of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. What does this mean?
I believe that I am
thank you. has made us kings and priests and God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord from James 5. Be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. This is our text. Your friend in Christ Jesus, our Lord, be patient. Now, there's some law for the day. For an example, we have John the Baptist in our gospel lesson. It seems that John was growing impatient, and who could blame him? Obedient to the Lord, he had lived in the wilderness on a diet of locusts and wild honey. He had stood on the banks of the Jordan River and proclaimed repentance to all of Judea. He had baptized Jesus and identified him as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He hadn't flinched. He was no respecter of persons. In fact, when Herod married his brother's wife, John called him to repentance for the sake of his soul. In thanks for John's concern, Herod had him thrown in prison. So John was in prison precisely for proclaiming God's word, and the devil always exploits suffering to tempt to doubt and impatience. If Jesus was, in fact, the Messiah, why was the forerunner languishing in Herod's prison? Finally, John sent disciples to ask Jesus, "Are you the one who is to come, or shall we look for another?" Jesus' response teaches us a lot. "Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk. Lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them. And blessed is the one who is not offended by me." What did Jesus mean? He was giving John a definite yes to his question. Don't just take my word for it, take the word for it. In Isaiah 35, the prophet had declared that when the Messiah would come, he would prove that he was the Christ by working miracles. "Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a deer, and the tongue of the mute sing for joy." Jesus' message to John in prison was this: the scriptures declare that the Messiah will work these miracles. I do miracles. Therefore, yes, I am the Messiah. By answering, Jesus fulfilled another prophecy from Isaiah. He was proclaiming liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to those who are bound. How did this help John? It was the Lord's promise that prison wouldn't last forever for John, because Jesus had come to deliver him to eternal life. Even though John remained a prisoner and would eventually be executed, he could say, even though Jesus has not worked such a miracle for me yet, he has proven that he is my Savior, and so he will deliver me. Thus Jesus said, "Blessed is the one who is not offended." that he was not delivered right away on his timetable, he would reject Jesus and look for another. But by God-given patience, he could wait for Jesus' deliverance in his time, according to his divine wisdom, and John would be blessed with eternal life. Our epistle instructs you, be patient. John lost his head to Herod's axe before he was delivered. He was delivered in the Lord's time. He is numbered with the company of heaven as he sings with angels and archangels. Aside from John the Baptist, our epistle gives you a few more examples to consider. The life of the Christian is more like farming than a production line. You patiently wait to see the growth, the fruit, and then the harvest. You don't get to press a button and watch a machine spit out the finished product. You can't hurry the Lord's plan. You can live as one who trusts his promises and seeks to obey his commands from day to day, trusting that deliverance is coming. That's the life of patience. Be patient. The text also sets before you the example of Old Testament prophets. Jeremiah, for example, was known as the weeping prophet for the suffering he endured and the trouble that he witnessed. Not one of those preachers was known as the happy-go-lucky prophet. They proclaimed God's law to a world that didn't want to hear it, and they spoke of the coming Savior to people who opted trust in Baal and hope for immediate help instead. For their faithfulness, they were rejected, beaten, and killed. As Hebrews would say to us, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood. Be patient. Finally, our text points you to the example of Job, a man who had everything, then had everything taken away. Sitting on the ash heap that was once his house, shredded by the death of all of his children and the loss of all his possessions, he said, only by God-given faith and patience, the Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The multiple blows did not distract him from the promises of God's faithfulness and deliverance, his compassion and mercy. The Lord preserved him from impatience as an example to you and me. Be patient. Be patient. James wasn't writing about patience with everyday annoyances. He was not telling you to not honk when the driver in front of you is slow to the green light. He wasn't telling you to honk either, by the way. He was telling you to be patient about the Lord's coming. He was telling you, like Job and the prophets and John the Baptist, not to be deluded by suffering into thinking that you are God forsaken. He was telling you to wait patiently for the Lord's deliverance, because here in statistical averages, you've got a good shot at living on Earth for about 28,000 days. And you are spending a good part of one of them here right now. Not every day has the same quality and opportunities. You spend the first of your helpless life as a little one in a cradle, unable to do anything. You spend the next many years enjoying life as a child without realizing the weight of responsibilities to come. Later days are slowed by pains and weakening. In between are those productive years, and your days are largely your own, but the clock is on and it's not your friend. Will you have enough time to get the book report done and turned in? Will you have enough time to get your thoughts on paper in the morning before your mind tires? Will you reach your goal of a certain career position before you reach middle age? Will you meet a mate in time, in a time frame that you have in mind? Will you have kids too? Will you make enough money to retire? Will you live long enough to see your grandchildren? Will you have a relatively pain-free life? Will you have a long period of mental anguish or physical suffering or worse? And when you do suffer, when will you be delivered? Don't be deceived. The answers are easy when we talk about them clinically in a Bible class. But when you are the one asking them in a personalized pain, the questions are bitter ones.
Judgment. If you are unwilling to wait on
patience is not a work that God demands before he saves you. Patience is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. In other words, God does not say, as soon as you prove that you are patient enough to trust in my promises, then I'll take away your sins. Instead, he says, my child, impatience is part of the curse of sin into which you were born. Your days are numbered in this life because the wages of sin is death. And as long as you are in this world, there will be trouble, and the kingdom of heaven will suffer violence. That is why I sent my only begotten Son. He came in the flesh for you. He patiently bore your sins to the cross and endured shame and death and hell. Now he is risen, and because he is risen from the dead, you have the certain hope of eternal life without the tyranny of time. I will raise you up in my time. In the meantime, you have my word, you have my mercy and compassion in the meantime. And as I send my Holy Spirit to you, I also give you the gift of patience. My dear friends, when you are tempted by impatience with the Lord and his ways, confess that for the sin that it is. If you give in to the temptation and forsake him, you will have deliverance neither now nor later. Confess that impatience for what it is, for Jesus has died for all sin, as he has patiently endured the cross. He is still patient with you. At your baptism, he said, I am with you always. And that's a faithful promise of patience, of long suffering. He still gathered you to hear his word and to receive his Holy Supper. He still forgives you for all of your sins. He forgives you for impatience. And should you be impatient again, then confess it again. He forgives you for all of your sins. Thus, St. Peter declares, the Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. By the grace of God, be patient. The ultimate day of deliverance is coming, and as you wait, take heart. Your Savior is the one who made the blind see, the deaf hear, the lame leap like a deer, the mute tongue to shout for joy. He did so to prove that he was the Messiah. In doing so, he also gave you a preview of the last day, a foretaste of the healing feast to come. Your patience will be renewed by the same God who gives it. You will see. You will hear. You will leap like a deer and shout for joy on the last day. God will wipe away every tear from your eyes. All of this is yours for sure, even now for Jesus' sake, because you are forgiven for all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. to life everlasting. Amen. Stand. This morning we confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From whence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Father of all mercy, the visitation of your Son has enlightened the darkness of our hearts, and every corner of creation hear us as we pray in his name and according to his will. O God, who have sent messengers to prepare the way of your Son's coming, grant us ears to hear and hearts to believe the words delivered by pastors and all who bear your words, for in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Lord, you have instituted the home to be a refuge for husbands and wives, and a place of growth and safety for children. Look with favor upon the homes of our land, and grant that the faith might be delivered from one generation to the next. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Precious Lord, you rule over all things in heaven and on earth. Until that day when your Son comes in glory to usher in his kingdom, give wisdom and insight to all leaders, that we may live peaceable lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, prompt by day, look for the day when blind eyes would see, deaf ears would hear, lame legs would leap, and new tongues would sing. Until the final day of restoration, draw near to all who have requested our prayers, especially for us, up, and give them healing according to your gracious will. Bind up those who grieve, that they may look for the resurrection of all flesh. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
With great jubilation, O Lord, we rejoice at your disciples saying, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for the remission of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
all proceedings.
Lord, would your coming and your going out and this not forth and be. Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed over me.